The voices of First World War poetry have been muted cannot be a matter of dispute. In the course of my research, I've discovered around 400 volumes of poetry written by Americans wholly or in significant part about the First World War. Yes, 400. Right, you heard the number correctly. In addition, there is a large body of poetry never incorporated into a volume, some of it, of course, never even published. The overwhelming majority of this is no longer read. Of course, not everything is going to survive. Franco Moretti refers to the destiny of most writing to disappear from memory as the slaughterhouse of literature. But this leaves open the question of why and how some particular writing survives, while the rest does not. Or in the terms of this conference, why and how are some, in this case most, voices muted while a very few others are not. The mechanisms by which writers of this era were muted vary. Songwriter Joe Hill of the Industrial Workers of the World was muted in the most direct way, executed by a firing squad after being found guilty of a murder that he almost certainly did not commit. The journal Seven Arts, publisher of the anti-war essayist Randolph Bourne, had its funding pulled by its patron, who was pressured by her pro-war family. From 1917 to 1919, such direct or slightly indirect methods prevailed. But what about later years? Here we enter an intricate situation where historical and theoretical specificity becomes of paramount importance if we want to develop a real understanding. The most common source of muting for poetry published during this period is the post-war dominance of modernist aesthetics based on a particular understanding of the aesthetics of Immanuel Kant. This is a pretty familiar story in literary studies, but since not everyone is going to be coming from the same background, I'll rehearse it briefly, but hopefully in such a way as to be of interest to those already familiar. The poetic world of the first two decades of the 20th century was rather different from that which would follow. All right. I'm trying to go for, oh, I got it. I was going backward with no backward to go to.
Give it to me.
All right.
Let's see if I can.
Turned on.
You turned on?
The remote.
Oh, the remote has to be.
Sure. Battery? Is it on?
Okay. It's on now.
Okay, let's see if we got it. Let's see if it...
There we go.
There you go, sir.
So, the poetic world of the first two decades of the 20th century was rather different from that which would follow. To some extent, it was still dominated by the great figures of the 19th century, the schoolroom poets Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, James Russell Lowell, William Cullen Bryant, Oliver Wendell Holmes, and John Greenleaf Whittier, all of whom had three names, as you can hear. The last of them died in 1894, but no successor generation of poets had emerged. The closest thing, the so-called genteel poets, were keenly aware that the schoolroom poets were a tough act to follow. And for this, they resented them deeply, although secretly, since one could not voice such heresy in public. There were exceptions. Walt Whitman was there, an acknowledged, somewhat rakish presence. He would provide some of the impetus to the new poetry, and more broadly, the new sensibility that became dominant after the war. And James Whitcomb Riley was wildly popular, although his dialect poetry often relied upon a sentimentality found throughout much of the 19th century literature. By the beginning of World War I, things were beginning to change, but only just. A prominent voice of the day was that of Henry Van Dyke, whom I will take as the exemplar of the poetic culture still dominant at the time of the war. Van Dyke was eminently respectable, a Presbyterian minister, English professor at Princeton, and ambassador to Luxembourg and the Netherlands from 1913 to 1916. His poem, America's Prosperity, written during the period of American neutrality, presents formal and thematic features typical of the traditional literary culture of 100 years ago. They tell me thou art rich, my country. Gold and glittering flood has poured into thy chest. Thy flocks and herds increase. Thy barns are pressed with harvest, and thy stores can hardly hold their merchandise. Unending trains are rolled along thy network rails of east and west. Thy factories and forges never rest. Thou art enriched in all things bought and sold. But dost thou prosper? Better news I crave. O dearest country, is it well with thee indeed? And is thy soul in health? A nobler people, hearts more wisely brave, and thoughts that lift men up and make them free? These are prosperity and vital wealth. So this poem features, first, closed form. It's a Petrarchan sonnet featuring the typical rhyme scheme, ABBA, ABBA, CDE, CDE, an organization of content. Second, a clear, direct argument. Third, a minimum of sensuous immediacy. There's not much by way of imagery. Fourth, idealism. The war, which is in the background here, is understood as what I call anti-economic. To attend to the moral urgencies of the war is to disregard economic material interest. And fifth, antiquated diction, right? All those thys and these and thous. Much of the poetry written in support of American intervention, both before and after the fact, resembles this. It is, to a great extent, the poetry of the traditional literary culture as it existed in the first two decades of the century. Things change in the 1920s. This established literary culture doesn't disappear, but it is challenged and to a large degree defeated by an insurgent literary culture that questioned all of the features, right, that I have listed on that slide there. This insurgent culture challenged the established culture on aesthetic grounds, but these aesthetic grounds were often linked to an ethical, political critique of the society that provided the basis of the established literary culture. A part of this critique focused on the overly instrumentalist nature of American culture, its subordination of all value to practical utility. Practical utility is not a quality of beauty, at least in something like a poem. And so one often finds a militant defense of beauty as a feature of this insurgent culture. If you're familiar with, say, E.E. Cummings, he would be a good example of that. Just as in the 19th century, in a reaction against moral earnestness, beauty was embraced, something we see with the decadence in England and traces of which can be found in American poets such as the young Ezra Pound. The rejection of practical utility and elevation of beauty and pleasure had a political dimension to it insofar as it objected to the use of poetry to justify and promote a war that was depicted in most published verse from 1917 to 1920 as a redemptive crusade to make the world safe for democracy and to end war. But something curious happened. The objection to the enlistment of poetry in the cause of what came to be seen by some as lies about the significance of American involvement in the war became confused with an objection to poetry engaging in the social and the political altogether. These are not the same thing, but the confusion is well illustrated by some lines from one of the survivors of the slaughterhouse of literature, Ezra Pound. In Husserl and Moberly, Pound writes that veterans walked eye-deep in hell, believing in old men's lies, then unbelieving came home, home to a lie, home to many deceits, home to old lies and new infamy, usury age-old and age-thick, and liars in public places. I will not attempt a complete commentary on these lines here, but just note that the phenomenon of liars in public places could be responded to in different ways. One, don't lie. Two, avoid public places. And there's a Henny Youngman joke in the background there, but I'm skipping that. While these are two different responses, they came to be seen as very similar, if not the same, especially when the new poetry of the teens and 20s, or at least some of it, became affiliated with what was known as the new criticism that gestated in the 1920s, absorbing the influence of the criticism of Pound and T.S. Eliot, exchanged blows with Marxist and traditional historicist criticism and theory in the 1930s, and conquered the commanding heights of criticism in the 1940s. The post-war literary reaction against the war, which was a political act, or more precisely, a cultural act with a significant political dimension, became assimilated to the rejection of the social and political dimension of culture within the new criticism. One of the writers present at the time, Josephine Herbst, quite interesting novelist for those of you who are not familiar with her, has commented on this and the mischaracterization of the 1920s it has produced. If the 20s has become a kind of fetish, may it not be because the 30s has been isolated as a sort of Bluebeard's chamber where the key lies rusted in a pool of blood? The door has been shut and footsteps scamper past the room in an embarrassed rush to that pleasanter beyond, the 20s, where we were all presumed to have been so lighthearted, so irresponsible, so foolish, and so lost, and so aesthetic. It is as if the events had been deliberately lost sight of or did not matter. There is robust evidence that Herbst is correct in her understanding in the 1920s. And here I want to shift from the general, which I've been looking at so far, to the specific by discussing the work of a poet with whom Herbst was almost certainly had no contact, someone she almost certainly never read, never even suspected that he existed, Lindley Grant Long. Lindley Grant Long was a native of Ohio, a graduate of the University of Michigan Law School, who went on to be a judge in Dayton, where he had practiced law. Long published 3 volumes of poetry. Of these, 1, Farmer Hiram on the World's War, is of immediate interest to us. And it's a little too dark, but there's a nice little picture of Farmer Hiram up there for you. Before I look at Farmer Hiram in any detail, I should note that the reasons why Farmer Hiram on the World's War did not survive are multiple. Not only did it not conform to the aesthetic standards that became dominant in the mid-20th century literary world, it was also published by the Christian Publishing Association, not a platform from which to gain the all-important book reviews in the New York Times, Herald Tribune, The New Republic, The Nation, and so on. So, I mean, it was significantly hobbled right from the start. Farmer Hiram on the World's War is an encyclopedic poem, offering a view of the entire war from its Balkan beginnings to its resolution in the halls of Versailles. Over 270 pages long, the poem is written in rhyming couplets in an unusual 11-syllable meter consisting of an initial iamb followed by 3 anapests, and I'll illustrate the metrical pattern in a moment. The poem speaker, Farmer Hiram, speaks in a resolutely colloquial voice, and the play between the poem's epic ambitions and Midwestern rural dialect provides one of its staple sources of irony and grim humor. Published, as I said, by the Christian Publishing Association, Farmer Hiram is informed by Christianity, but rejects the heavily religious-tinged view of the war offered by the Wilson administration. The Wilson administration presented the war, quite famously, as a crusade, in which the New World in the form of the US would redeem the fallen Old World of Europe in an ideologically complex version of the 17th century American Puritan errand into the wilderness. Long's, or at least Farmer Hiram's, Christian vision, as we will see, contains a strong dose of skepticism about institutional power and the nature of economic interest, and this skepticism wholly undermines the Wilsonian vision of the war. Long establishes the tone of the poem in a brief foreword. In making his bow, Farmer Hiram asks no apologies and begs nobody's pardon. He did not cause the war, nor even suggest it, but has simply attempted to tell the plain, unvarnished story of the tragic affair. This tone, established through the comic use of the rhetorical device adenaton, is appropriate to a poem written in a determinedly colloquial voice. Long's poem is filled with incident, the relating of which occupies most of Farmer Hiram's attention as he attempts to convey his plain, unvarnished story of the tragic affair. Farmer Hiram thus aspires to that which Hegel sees as essential to the epic mode, objective presentation, in that which being related is emphasized over the sensibilities and emotional experiences of the speaker or the characters. Long admits to didactic purpose. Farmer Hiram felt an impelling duty to write a true history of the great conflict and thereby render a service to mankind by rescuing posterity from a perverted and improper conception of the same. However, despite this didactic purpose, Long avoids any suggestion of high-mindedness. The poem's seriousness of purpose never becomes lost in, nor a hindrance, to its refusal to take the war on the terms put forward by its proponents, British, French, German, or American. The sprightliness of the verse contributes to this. The unusual 11-syllable line moves quickly and is well suited to Farmer Hiram's cheerful skepticism. Farmer Hiram avoids antiquated diction. The speaking voice is a version of Midwestern rural dialect descended from Mark Twain by way of James Whitcomb Riley. And this produces a predominantly, what I call, deflationary rhetoric, whereby the otherwise world historical events of the poem often appear petty, familiarized by the language. Farmer Hiram's voice contrasts with the poem's epic scope. The one is decidedly, unapologetically local, the other spans the globe. Farmer Hiram opens with the origin of the war, something he admits to having limited knowledge of, even as he feels confident to draw a conclusion. And here I've illustrated the meter by putting the stress syllables in capital letters. Also, I should note at this point that my accent does not allow me to do justice to Farmer Hiram's voice, and so there are going to be lines that should rhyme that are not going to, because I just can't say it that same way without, you know, making one of us sound like a fool and let you decide who it would be. To one perched outside, looking in through a crack, it appears that old Franz heaved a bone to the pack, and the hull snarling kennel, primed for a scrap, just bristled right in, and so there's the first lap. Hiram's perspective may restrict what he can know of the details of the assassination of the Archduke, but the result demonstrates the nature of the combatant nations, allied and central alike. They are no better than a pack of ill-tempered dogs. This characterization is typical in refusing to regard the combatants with the seriousness with which they take themselves. A persistent theme in Farmer Hiram is the role of economic interest in determining opinion and action. It first appears in chapter 5 when Hiram discusses the pressure on neutral nations to align with one side or the other. It slowly developed but later grew plain that somebody's pockets were in for some gain. You can't have a war without powder and guns and something to eat and a whole lot of funds. Each neutral stood ready to serve his own friends and salve up his conscience with prayers for amends. I've often observed when it's time to disperse, a deacon's emotions run close to his purse. So each sidled up to the one that could pay, and that's how the most of them got in the fray. Not only does Long have Farmer Hiram espouse an economic interpretation of the conduct of neutral nations, he expresses this interpretation in language considerably less pious than that of most poetry of the era. When Long turns to the intervention of the U.S. into the war, he maintains his objective stance and attempts to give a full account of the matter. Hiram summarizes the nature and effect of the British blockade of Germany and the feeble U.S. objections to it, as well as the German response, which led, among other things, to the sinking of the Lusitania, or the Lucy, as Hiram calls it, in 1915. When William had watched Samuel's bluff to the end and give up all hoping that Johnny would mend, he started right out to do something himself and didn't much care who he laid on the shelf. He oiled up his subs and went straight for John's throat and told other folks to look out for their goat. His aim was to get him right under the gills and poke down his neck a few red pepper pills, and maybe he'd then come across and be good and let starving kids have a few scraps of food. It worked pretty well till the Lucy went down, and that made the world kind of take on a frown. The German case that the naval blockade by the British was starving its civilian population is briefly noted, as is the presence of munitions aboard the Lusitania. Of course, 'twas John's vessel and bore contraband, and under the rules and the law of the land, he had ample reason to capture or sink, but drowning the women's what caused all the stink. Sam's folks had had warning before they went on, and most people allowed that they shouldn't have gone. But William soon found that he'd made a bad break, and while not confessing his foolish mistake, he promised to settle with neutrals and Sam and pay all the damage if they would keep calm. While this was agreed to, it left a bad taste and give John a chance to get round Sammy's waist. Long presents not only the outline of the facts of the case, the Lusitania was indeed carrying munitions, and the American public had been warned by the German government, but also the effect of the Lusitania sinking on American public opinion. While the sinking of the Lusitania drew the U.S. closer to the U.K., it did not draw the U.S. into the war. For that, money was necessary. One Phelan Sam has, and that Johnny well knew. He loves the long green, and so there is your clue. The U.S. pursuit of economic interests determined American entry into the war, since that was where the long green was. Hiram expands on this, presenting American involvement as an outcome of American lending to the Allies, who would be unable to repay were they defeated. You may think you're free, but your bonds bind you tight. 'Twas Morgan, not Morals, got Sam in the fight. He'd sold and he'd sold till he had all their cash. When people can't pay, business soon goes to smash. 'Twas either get in and take uncovered notes, or eat your own pumpkins and rye bread and shoats. Gold ain't got no conscience and would just as lief to make itself safe, plunge the whole world to grief. The truth plainly spoken, that's just what was done. So don't blame it all on the brutalized Hun. Farmer Hiram avoids the emotionalism of the view put forward in Allied propaganda, particularly the doctrine of German responsibility for the war. Don't blame it all on the brutalized Hun. Farmer Hiram goes on to provide a panoramic view of the war and the post-war negotiations, which he summarizes pointedly. So blamed many hogs, and so blamed little Swill. For Hiram, the war amounts to little but waste and ruin, and lacks the profound meaning that many found in it. In this, Long's poem is of a piece with the literature of the disillusionment that became dominant and which is quite familiar to people. But the explicit and protracted engagement, however critical, with the public places of the war helped ensure that this carefully constructed and far from artless poem would disappear.